Hi, it's a lovely Saturday, nice sunny day, makes a nice change here in Brixham. It's the end of June, the weather's been absolutely dire. You can probably hear church bells fading off in the distance there. I've got Joel here in the workshop working with Joel's my 17-year-old son who's working his way into a full-time apprenticeship with me. I'm chuffed about it. He seems to be quite chuffed. He's working on a chain at the moment. Joel, do you want to pass me a piece of your chain? It's not hot, is it? He's learned, don't burn dad. So this is a chain he's been making, sterling silver. And now he's going through the process of actually soldering all of the links. This is a really good exercise, in my opinion, for apprentices, trainees. Making the links takes time, obviously. Soldering them takes even more time. But it really does teach you how to solder very well and accurately. And then to turn this into a curved chain, that is to say the links all lay flat, you have to put it one end in a vise and twist it. And if your solder joints are not up to it, they'll break. So by the time you've made a 45 centimeter chain, which is what Joel's doing, he will have learned how to solder accurately and effectively. So when I was an apprentice, we made quite a few chains in brass, starting with this thickness. Then we went much, much bigger, which really does put a lot of strain on the solder joints when you twist them. And then we went very small the other direction. We ended up making sort of 3-inch sections of tiny trace chain as well, with the mouth blowtorch that I still use. So that's what Joel's doing. That's not on my bench, Joel. There you go. I've been working on a few things this week. Some I can't show you. Restoration work, which is not always best shown to everybody. I have been working on a number of private projects, commissions. This one, I've had a few pictures, I think, on Instagram, and I'll talk about this in a minute. And also the old dragonfly Fushikashira. I've moved on to other aspects of this project now, including the Manuki, the Uchidashi project I started ages ago. But I'll talk about these a little bit more in detail and in close-up. This is a tsuba that was commissioned. It's my interpretation of an antique piece, which the client has already. It features a stream and some autumn foliage. I think these are Japanese clover. And the other side will have a little rabbit looking up towards the moon. The iron is old wrought iron, about 120 years old, we believe. Michael Coffey forged this plate out for me. I then worked it further. And what I did was, whereas it was a flat plate, I forged it so it's got a bit of a taper towards the edges. A perfectly flat plate, in my opinion, is perfectly dull. It doesn't look right to the eyes, a flat, hard plate. So by giving it a very gentle taper towards the edge, still keeping a relatively flat edge, but just tapering it a little bit, it just feels better in the hand and provides a more gentle, full feeling when you look at it. What I really wanted was a very subtle stone forged surface, which is what I've applied. When I do this, I really don't want the hammer marks to be too overt, too rough. I'm really trying to simulate a naturally worn rock surface or pebble. For me, I find that most satisfying. And then, of course, the decoration needs to be really rather light. The stream, of course, just gently flowing across the surface, this series of ripples. And I took a lot of care to get that as nice and smooth as possible. So it provides a very soothing, gentle contrast with the soft stone surface. So that in itself, regardless of composition, is just an aesthetic interplay, these two surfaces and these lines. They also sort of echo my signature, which is quite flowing, but that's a feature of all my pieces, the signature, of course. But I it's important for me that there's a relationship. The Nakagawana, this hole, isn't just a functional hole on a tsuba. I favour this particular shape. I think it's been joked about that it looks a little bit like a Perrier water bottle. But yeah, so that's the shape I like. And I try to, where I can, make the Nakagoana exactly the same. So my works will feature that detail. When I design, of course, I have a template for the sepa die area, the area where the handle will fit. And so I design around that. And it's important that there be enough space in this instance, that the composition doesn't look cramped or trapped at all. One of the secrets of Japanese and Chinese painting is that there's always room for the imagination. There's always an area for the composition to reach into, providing this potential space. And it provides a sort of dynamic counterpoint. So you've got some activity going on here, albeit very gentle and tranquil. There is this void that speaks of potential and possibilities, things growing and reaching into it. You see that in a lot of paintings. The other side of this piece is a little rabbit. I had done a few studies and came up with this composition. So the rabbit's busy eating, but then is captivated by the moon, which will be up here in the top left-hand corner, partly hidden by clouds. The idea is that the moon has captivated the rabbit with his beauty, so much so that he's distracted from eating the clover. I drew the hair a few times and then sketched it directly on the suba, just to see how it would fit. What I do when I'm drawing directly onto iron is I use Chinese white paint. That was a trick I got from Henry Spencer, the renowned New England chaser and gentleman. So I dab that on the surface just to provide a matted finish on the iron, and then I can readily draw with a pencil. So yeah, this composition worked for me, and a couple of people commented that they loved it as it was. Bella was quite insistent that I not alter it. So I have very lightly gone over with a scriber to mark it in. The original, the entire rabbit, very different pose, is in intaglio or shishaibori. That's where you outline the piece with a V-chisel and then sculpt within that. So the entire sculpted piece is below the surface of the metal. It's very effective. It looks very three-dimensional. I shall do the same with the lower part of the body, but the head and that ear I intend to inlay. So there'll be a very slight transition to relief on these. That one will be sunken relief. Just to add my own touch to the composition, I actually add a little bit more perspective, and really to bring attention to the characterful face. I really want to try and capture a sort of quizzical, curious expression to the hair. And I really want to make the most of these lovely sculpted ears. They're almost like petals of a flower. And then the body, of course, is the fur will be the main feature of that. And over here, of course, we'll have a little moon, partially obscured by clouds. That's quite a minimalistic rendering. So the detail will all be here. And then there'll be a bit more foliage and flowers as per the other side. But that's all I can show you on this one. This one has to remain under wraps as we proceed. Once the client has it, I'll be able to show you everything in between. And these are the Fujikasha that I've nearly finished up. I've moved on to other aspects of this project. These are, for the most part, finished. What I'm doing now is fiddling with the final patina. If you've seen images of this as I was proceeding, of course, the iron was bright grey, silver was very white, and the shibuichi was, of course, pink. It makes it very difficult with all those bright colours to imagine what it's going to look like and how successful the design is. So what I've done now is I've got a fairly quick iron patina and a rough and ready patina on the shibuichi. It's not the true color. And I've tarnished the silver wings using chloroauric acid. There's no sulfur involved in the way I work. What I really wanted to see was how the lines work, how the overall form and aesthetic idea that I had was coming together. What I really didn't want was something too in your face, too bright, too hard. I really wanted to create something quite moody, quite mysterious, the wings disappearing as they do, and I think that has worked quite successfully. And then, of course, the chiseling, detailing of the wings is one of my, I suppose, one of my hallmarks, especially with my dragonflies. I think that's worked really rather well. I decided with the eyes in this incarnation of dragonflies to a very, very fine pin punch texture. So it's given the eyes a sort of a velvety effect, which I think sort of better reflects the sort of impression you get when you see a dragonfly. So I'm quite pleased with that. The iron pattern, the iron texture has this, it's called shirimen in Japanese, and it relates to a crepe silk. And the reason I chose that was because the artist most associated with dragonflies, in my mind, in the Tosoku tradition, is Murakami Jochiku. And he used this crepe silk effect. And this is my nod to him. But it actually works quite nicely, I think, with the soft sort of gossamer effect of the wings to have this almost furry iron background. I think it all works together rather well. The pattern is a little bit thin at the moment. It's a perfectly decent color, but it feels a little bit plasticky to me, a little bit unsatisfying. So I will be cleaning this all back completely and over the next week or so, allowing a natural rust to form, which I will then remove and repatternate. Then the iron will have a much more natural, organic feel to it. I don't want to use acids to soften the iron at this point. There's too much delicate detail in the rest of the materials to risk that. So, but the moodiness and the overall sculptural qualities I was after, I think are there. I'm quite happy with this. It feels for me both very contemporary in design and execution, but also there's something quite vintage about them. I think they would not automatically make you think of a contemporary piece. So I'm quite happy with that blend I've managed to achieve here. And here's the fushi. What I should have said also is that in terms of designing these, I literally just took some ink on a brush and sketched in the rough forms. With no real, I mean, I'm quite familiar with dragonflies, but I really wasn't, and I'm never aiming for anatomical perfection or insect study or whatever. I'm really just interested in the forms and the textures. So these wings were just drawn fairly haphazardly, and then I'm left with the challenge of how to do the inlay. Of course, inlay that disappears off the edge of things is always quite tricky because there's nothing holding it in there. But I've devised some techniques that work rather well. So this wing's in the front. That wing behind is level with the iron here, but there's a tiny ridge there to catch the light, and on the tip, the very tip, it's just slightly proud, just enough to catch the light and contrast with the iron background. Similarly, on this side, the wing comes forward, disappears off the edge, it's level over here, a little bit of a ridge here, and this one behind is level with the ground all the way and just disappears as it goes around. But the lines are what interests me. Japanese designs with dragonfly often look as though the dragonflies have been soaked in boiling water and then draped over things. The wings are deliberately allowed to flop around. I'm not a huge fan of that way of dealing with the subject. For me, dragonflies are quite flighty, helicoptery type things, and I really like that dynamic. However, I have got curves and lines which are inherent in the shapes of the wings, and there is a sort of a little nod with these sloping lines to the Japanese approach, but these curves are actually in dragonfly wings anyway, so trying to get that balance right is satisfying. And he looks quite a powerful little predator here. I quite like how that's worked out. So
I think the set, when it's done, will be quite a powerful little sculptural ensemble. I'm satisfied with them.